This is Friday Evening's Undercard. On our wrestling show today, Thunderkitty turns off a television, King's Ransom calls out the War Kings, and Colton Cage goes through a table. Welcome, everyone, to this episode of Friday Evening's Undercard. I'm Gentleman John. I'm your host. Got to do this one solo today. Eric's busy. Man's got a lot of things going on, and he was feeling under the weather. Couldn't make it out for this one. So I'm doing this episode of Ohio Valley Wrestling solo. We're going to be doing episode 1021 today. So episode 1021, obviously this is the first episode back after the big Clash in the Bluegrass show. It opens up with a promo from Scott D'Amore and Tony Gunn in the ring. This was after the Clash in the Bluegrass, and it was basically Scott saying, hey, Tony, you did a great job, and we're going to basically, you're going to have an opportunity to prove yourself on Impact TV coming up shortly. You know, I really like this because certainly we've had Tony Gunn on the show twice. You can go back and listen to the interviews that we did with him. He's a great interview. Great guy. It's definitely somebody that I think is a great representative of Ohio Valley Wrestling. And so I think this is great that he's going to get an opportunity to go to Impact and to see what he can do there. Hopefully they get him a couple of matches and he can get some good exposure on TV. Regardless, you know, it's going to be a great opportunity for him. All right. The first match on the show, we get Thunderkitty coming down, and she's going against Valerie Verman. She was introduced by the ring announcer as being 93. I thought she was 97. And Gilbert Corsi notes that he thought she was 97 as well. So I guess maybe we're just forgetting, or maybe that's just like part of the running joke that we don't know how old she is. Either way, it worked. Whether it was a botch or not, it worked. It was funny. And, you know, at the end of the day, we're dealing with somebody who says she's 97 years old. So you got to do something funny with it. You can't treat it as being too serious, or it's just going to be weird, right? So she's going against Valerie Verman. You know, not a heck of a lot to say about the match. It goes for 2 minutes. They did a good back and forth. Kitty hit a good running knee and puts Valerie in the Boston Crab for the win. Match went about 2 minutes. Overall, for the rating scale that we brought out last week, I mean, this one's a two. It's a good average match. It's not a bad match, which, I mean, a one is just a bad match or something that goes, you know, 30 seconds. I think there probably is one down here that might. No, actually, there's not. I'll get there. The next segment, you go into the back, and you've got Shiloh and DO3 dancing back there. Thunderkitty comes in and basically asks what they're doing. There was a TV on that just had, like, the oh man, what am I trying to think? Like the test signal, I think it is, where it's just like the vertical lines, which I haven't seen on TV in years. But she said she was looking for the knobs to turn the TV off. And obviously, I mean, this is like a modern flat screen TV, and it doesn't have knobs, but it's just kind of a funny joke. And she says that Shiloh and DL3 look like circus clowns. She's kind of right. They sort of do look like circus clowns. After that, you get Sam Thompson come out. The fans are booing him. I don't understand. Maybe I missed something. But either way, there's a really vocal part of the crowd that's booing him. There's some signs like right dead opposite the hard camera that's saying like Sam sucks. And it's got like a picture of a rubber duck with a line through it and stuff like that. So he comes out. He calls out Cash Flow. There's a part of this where I had to note that his voice reminds me of Owen Hart's. Especially when Owen Hart was running that gimmick where he was part of the Nation and he was saying that he wasn't a nugget. I don't know if that's Sam's point, but his voice definitely sounds like Owen Hart's. It says he wants another opportunity against Cash Flow in the Chop Challenge. Yeah, I don't understand these segments, especially if the crowd's booing. I still don't understand them. They do a few chops back and forth, and then Cash gives Sam a buckle bomb. And that's the end of it. Yeah, I mean, that's that. Just a quick break in the action, ladies and gentlemen. If you want to follow us on social media, we can be found on Instagram at Friday Evenings Undercard, on Twitter at F Undercard, on Facebook by going to facebook.com/fridayeveningsundercard, or you can reach us via email at fridayeveningsundercard@gmail.com. You can find Ohio Valley Wrestling online at ovwrestling.com. Please have a listen to our interviews with Ohio Valley Wrestling stars Tony Gunn, Sam Thompson, King's Ransom, and Callie. If you like what you hear, please subscribe and give us that 5-star review on iTunes. It'd mean a lot to us. Now, let's get you right back to the action. Next, you go into a segment in the back with King's Ransom. They're basically saying the War Kings are ducking and dodging him, not wanting to give him the title opportunity again. They bring up that King's Ransom, that the War Kings did not pin King's Ransom at the Clash in the Bluegrass, that they pinned the Void. That's true. You know, that's a way to get a definitive end to the match and also prolong this feud, which I think is great. Again, we've talked on the show here that, you know, we both think it's one of the best tag team feuds going. Definitely not just in OVW, but anywhere in professional wrestling right now, this is one of the best tag team feuds going. And so anything that they're willing to do to make this go longer, I'm definitely for. Ransom says they want a tag title match at the April 6th Saturday Night Special. Whether they'll get it or not, I mean, we'll see. Honestly, I hope they get it there, but don't win the belts. Like, they just really get shafted out of the belts. Like, the War Kings hit them with a low blow or something to intentionally get disqualified so that we can drag this on into May and June and see what we can do. But that's me hoping. That's also me not knowing sort of what the deal with the War Kings is. Next, we go into the tag title gauntlet. That would even be the TV title gauntlet. And apparently this is a really big one. Let's see. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different guys. I don't know. To me, it's getting a little big. You know, it was good when it was 5 challengers and then the champion. Now it's 9. I don't get it. So the first match of the night is Tanner Reynolds, or first match of the gauntlet. I mean, Tanner Reynolds against Dimes. They do a good back and forth. Obviously, Dimes is tremendously smaller than Tanner. That's the case with pretty much anything. Reynolds hits a big lariat out of the corner. It's actually the JBL, John Bradshaw Layfield, if you don't remember him. It's his finisher that Reynolds hits, the clothesline from hell, where he holds you by the arm, drags you in, and hits the clothesline on you. That did not get a pinfall on Dimes, and then they go back and forth a little bit, and then Dimes hits the lethal injection for the win. I don't know if they have a name that they specifically call this. It's Jay Lethal's finisher, and I'm not trying to disrespect Dimes by calling it this, but it's Jay Lethal's finisher. It's the lethal injection. If you watch wrestling, especially Ring of Honor, you're going to know what it is if you don't watch the product every week, OVW, that is. Then you get Nigel Winters coming out. Dimes immediately goes for the lethal injection. It gets countered. Gilbert Corsi notes again, because he has noted this before, that their first match ever was against each other, which, you know, is a good thing to build in. It doesn't. So this is something that's really good that I had a problem with something that WWE did last week. They had Shelton Benjamin come down and beat up Seth Rollins because Brock Lesnar was not there. But for somebody who hasn't followed wrestling for the last 20 years, why did Shelton Benjamin come down? And that was never explained by the commentators. And so it didn't make sense. Why does Shelton Benjamin care to come out of the locker room and attack Seth Rollins? Yes, they said Paul Heyman paid him, and so, I mean, I guess that's something. But why would Heyman go to Shelton Benjamin? Why would he not go to any number of other people? So they completely leave out the fact that Shelton Benjamin and Brock Lesnar used to be tag team partners in OVW. They were the Minnesota Stretching Crew. Minnesota Stretching Crew. I had that wrong. It's a play on the old Anderson tag team. So they give us no reason to care that Shelton Benjamin is down here in the ring, whereas here you get just a little bit of history between them. Hey, these guys, they're wrestling now, but their very first match was together. So these two, they've got history. They've been working against each other for a long time. Dimes has a headlock on Nigel that gets reversed into a good looking head scissors Really good looking match. Corsi notes that this is a 9-man gauntlet. I mentioned that before. He was like almost like flipping through his notes to try to find out how many people were there. Nigel wins the match with a roll up. And this is another one of those things that I don't know if it was intentional, but I think it works or could work if they wanted it to work. So Nigel rolls him up, but it looks like he almost rolls him over too far. And when I say too far, it's like, it's almost like Dimes was up on his head and that his shoulders weren't even on the mat. But because the ref was on the other side, you know, he counts it down. Whether or not that was intentional, hey, maybe it was, maybe it wasn't. Maybe he just rolled him over too far. But either way, that's something that you could build on with these two. Be like, hey, man, you didn't beat me. You rolled me over too far. I want a piece of you again. That match went 4 minutes and 2 seconds, had a commercial break in the middle. So that's kind of a rough time. That match is probably right on the edge of being a 3, maybe a 2. Let's give it a 3. So now you get Nigel Winters and Chace Destiny. Obviously, these two are tag team partners. This is the first time I've seen Chace Destiny since he did the casket match with Steve. He's out in a new set of trunks, and he's got black lipstick on. And I noted, I was like, man, is he trying to go for like a Marilyn Manson look? Because he's got like pitch black hair that was slicked back and black lipstick on. It's definitely a unique look, which is probably what he was going for. Cause I've spent a minute talking about it here. But so anyway, so they do a handshake to start the match. Always cool to see that. They do a quick back and forth. Chace hits what I'm guessing is his finishing move because it has a name. It's called the butterfly effect, which is an odd name for a move. I mean, I kind of know where it comes from, but it's odd. So the move is a front DDT. So he gets him in the reverse headlock like you would for a DDT. But then rather than falling down onto his back, Chace basically falls down onto his belly. And so they go out like at 180 degrees and he plants the face down like that. That match went 54 seconds. I'm probably going to say this one is a 1. I think this is the one I was thinking of. And it's not because they did a bad match. It's just because there's really nothing there. Nah, you know what? I'll say it's a 2. It's a 2. It was what it was. Then you get Chace Destiny against William Lutz. They do a quick roll-up to start. Get a backslide from Chace. 2 count. Springboard crossbody. Really good-looking move from William Lutz. Gets a 2 count. And then Chace hits the butterfly effect again, minute 46 seconds. And that one's going to get a 2 as well. And then Amon comes out. He basically jumps Chace before even the bell rings. So the time is estimated on this one because I don't know when to really start the timer. And then there was a commercial break too. So anyway, good back and forth. Amon gets Chace basically on his back and he does the Ryback spot where he grabs him. Looks like he's grabbing him by the neck and Chace basically grabs a hold of the two arms. He picks him up and slams the head down into the mat. Does that a couple times. If you watched WWE back in 2012 or 13, you would have seen Ryback doing that in every single match he ever did. And then you get a good little homage to Hulk Hogan over in the corner. Amon gets him in there and bites him on the head. We used to see Hulk Hogan do that quite a bit. Interesting for a face to do that. They probably wouldn't do that now, but it was weird because Hogan used to do it all the time. And then just really suddenly, Chace wins with a roll-up. Amon gets up and starts just really beating down Chace. So this one was 4 minutes and 20 seconds. Had a commercial break in there. Next one, Chace Destiny against Brandon Espinosa. I actually had to go back and rewatch a portion of this because I figured Espinosa was just going to come in and hit him one time and then get the 3 count. It was just going to be, you know, 5 or 6 seconds. But it ended up not being that. They ended up going for, they went for 37 seconds. So this is actually the match I would give a 1 because there's just nothing there. You end up with Espinosa hitting a spinning heel kick and a vertical suplex for the win. 37 seconds. There's just nothing to see. You know, the match is not bad. Like it's there's not like botches and all kinds of stuff like that, but there's not enough sample to like evaluate to say like if it was good. So I guess I got to say that one's a 1. Then you get Brandon Espinosa against Melvin Maximus. Melvin is definitely a power worker. You're not going to see cross bodies and stuff, or you know, big high flying moves. He's not Kenny Omega or something like that. He's an old school grounded type wrestler, does a lot of power moves and that sort of thing. Good back and forth. Yeah, I mean, there's not a heck of a lot to say. Just that they did a good back and forth, and Melvin hits that big running power slam for the win. And the final match of the gauntlet, you get Melvin Maximus against Colton Cage. Colton Cage comes down to the ring. His girlfriend Danny is not with him, and he is wearing. I want you to picture this in your head, ladies and gentlemen. He is wearing the Larry the Cable Guy version of a Canadian tuxedo. Not to insult any of our Canadian fans out there. Larry the Cable Guy version of a Canadian tuxedo. It is something to see. He's got these the acid wash jeans with all the holes in them. And, you know, but then he has on a jean jacket that he cut the sleeves off of. So it's a sleeveless, it's a vest, right? It's just like the Larry the Cable Guy sleeveless vest. And he's got it buttoned like, you know, three quarters of the way up. No shirt on underneath. I mean, it's a spectacle. It's just, oh, man. So once he removes the vest, he gets into the ring. Melvin hits him with a big shoulder tackle, sends him outside. Then Melvin ends up outside. Colton distracts the ref. As Melvin's trying to get in, he kicks the middle rope up into the Melvin's groin as Melvin's trying to get back in the ring. Melvin finally gets back in. He's doubled over. Colton hits the scissor kick for the win. Minute 26, solid two. You know, good average match. The next one, we get another interview with Tony Gunn. He's sitting, it's in the ring. It's like the interview that they did with him a couple of weeks ago where it's him and Gilbert. They're in the ring. They're sitting there. They're talking about the opportunity on Impact to his conversation with Scott DeMore. He talks about his upcoming matches. One of them was in E-Town, which is tonight as I'm recording this. It's probably already happened. After the Friday night show at E-Town, it's tomorrow as I'm taping this, so Saturday, March the 16th, at St. Gabriel the Archangel Catholic School, which is where Tony is one of the teachers. And so that's tomorrow night as I'm taping this. And then as he's in the middle of that, Justin Smooth comes out of the back. You know, he's doing like the slow clap thing and says, I didn't actually write down exactly what he says. He's basically enjoy it while it lasts. So I guess they're hinting that Smooth is going to be coming after Tony, maybe going into the April Saturday night special, but we'll see how that goes. Certainly they're setting up a feud with him and Smooth. After that, we go back out to the ring. It's a contract signing between Dustin Jackson and Colton Cage. Hey, spoiler alert, if you've never watched wrestling, contract signings are never just contract signings. So, Dustin comes out to the ring again wearing his white tank top. Once again, I don't know if that's the attire that I would have chosen. They go back and forth. Colton starts talking about Danny and he says, I don't hit him. I don't disrespect him. I just leave him satisfied all night long. And I'm like, man, he's bringing out the Ric Flair here. And then he starts talking about Colton and he says, Colton starts talking about Dustin and he says, you're just a kid I used to get to the top. And I'm like, well, that's interesting. And then we get introduced to Dustin Jackson's new girlfriend, who happens to be Colton Cage's ex-wife. Have mercy. Josh Ascrapt is on the commentary and he's like, this is low. Yes, Josh. Yes, it is. It's very low. Dustin powerbombs Colton through the table, stands over him, signs the contract, and you cut to black. And that's the show, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah, I mean, I like the stuff with Tony Gunn because I think he's, I don't know if I want to say a superstar, but I definitely think he's a star. He looks solid. You know, he walks around. He walks like somebody that's supposed to have a championship belt. In the interview that I did with him, I compared him to somebody like Nick Aldis because I think he does look like Nick Aldis. He's definitely somebody I could picture wearing a suit and going out and doing the exact same things that Nick Aldis does. He looks like a champion. So anytime he's on the TV, I'm a fan. I thought the gauntlet match for the TV title, it's 8 matches, 9 people. It's a little much. They worked good. I mean, they were decent matches overall, you know, good solid matches, but it's just, I don't know. It's hard to have that much going on. It's hard to follow. You kind of wonder like what's going on. I mean, it gives a lot of guys opportunity to, you know, say they're contenders, to put some guys over. I see what they're doing. It's just if you're doing nine people, man, that's getting to be a lot. Dustin Jackson and Colton Cage, man, I don't know what I think about that. So they're wrestling in a steel cage, which I don't mind. I don't have anything against them wrestling in a steel cage. That's a good thing. You know, they need to have a good proper blow off. But it's just really weird that, you know, now they're stealing each other's wives and girlfriends and stuff back and forth. And it just, man, I don't know. I feel like that's something, man, I really don't want to talk too bad about it. I don't know. I just, man, it's weird. And I think the reason it's so weird, and don't take this as any disrespect to the women, like the real life women involved in this, but the TV characters, Danny and now Colton's ex-wife, they're just cardboard cutouts that they're just kind of toting out there sort of as props. I don't have any invested reason, like, other than the fact that it was a woman that got hit, I didn't have any reason to care that Dustin knocked the daylights out of Danny a couple of weeks ago. I saw Nia Jax take an RKO at the Royal Rumble a couple weeks ago. So she got hit, but at least she had been on TV for a couple weeks. But now you've got this the ex, and it's like, I've never seen this person. I have no reason to like care about this person. So I don't know. So yeah, overall good episode of TV. You know, right now the biggest feud is one that I'm not enthused about. I wish I was. I wish I wasn't so down on it. But I don't. It's just meh. They look to be setting up for something good at the April SNS with Tony and Smooth. And they also look to be setting up something good with King's Ransom and the War Kings. And like I said with that one, I hope that one drags out for as long as it possibly can. I would love to see that one drag out into December, you know, with the War Kings just doing crazy stuff week after week to retain the belt, because that's going to build. It's going to build and build and build and build and just be solid, just really solid work. And it's going to be something that makes the fans care, right? Because eventually you're going to want to see King's Ransom win. I mean, yes, okay, we kind of want to see him win now, but the more they get sort of screwed around, as long as you can sort of see the point in it, the better it's going to be once they finally win. I mean, you think about Daniel Bryan when he won the world championship at WrestleMania 30. I mean, he'd been screwed around for 2 years since he lost the match in whatever, 7 or 8 seconds at WrestleMania 28. And so when he finally won at Mania 30, it was this massive, just the whole place just went crazy. And I think they can do the same thing with King's Ransom if they drag it out. But again, I don't know what the sort of situation with the War Kings is. I do know from some of, I've listened to some of Animals, because if you don't know, the War Kings are working with Road Warrior Animal. And I've listened to some of that I think they're trying to get some of the New Japan tours and some stuff like that. Obviously, Crimson is heavily involved in his own promotion, that being Tried and True, which is just down the road. You know, I could come up with some ideas, some fantasy booking ideas for that one, considering it's only about 2.5 hours down the road, right across the line into Tennessee. But that's neither here nor there. And obviously, Crimson and Jax are doing the Crockett Cup in Charlotte. That's at the end of April. So that should be, if they win that one, I don't know how involved they become with the NWA. So there's a lot going on as far as how much they can do there. But anyway, I believe that takes us just about to the end of this episode. I really appreciate everybody listening, and talk to you again next time.